everybody. I'm back again today with the Trumpet of the Swan. And today we're going to read Chapter 2, The Pond. You can see what's right there. The pond Sam had discovered on that spring morning was seldom visited by humans. All winter, snow had covered the ice. The pond lay cold and still under its white blanket. Most of the time, there wasn't a sound to be heard. The frog was asleep. The chipmunk was asleep. Occasionally, a blue jay would cry out. And sometimes at night, a fox would bark, a high, rasping bark. Winter seemed to last forever. But one day, a change came over the woods and the pond. Warm air, soft and kind, blew through the trees. The ice, which had softened during the night, began to melt. Patches of open water appeared. All the creatures that lived in the pond and in the woods were glad to feel the warmth. They heard and felt the breath of spring, and they stirred with new life and hope. There was a good new smell in the air, a smell of earth waking after a long sleep. The frog buried in the mud at the bottom of the pond knew that spring was here. The chickadee knew and was delighted. Almost everything delights a chickadee. The vixen, dozing in her den, knew that she would soon have kits. Every creature knew that a pleasant, better, easier time was at hand. Warmer days, warmer nights. Trees were putting out green buds. The buds were swelling. Birds began arriving from the south. A pair of ducks flew in. A red-winged blackbird arrived and scouted the pond for nesting sites. A small sparrow with a white throat arrived and sang, "Oh, sweet Canada, Canada, Canada." If you had been sitting by the pond on that first warm day of spring, suddenly, toward the end of the afternoon, you would have heard a stirring sound high above you in the air, a sound like the sound of trumpets. And if you looked up, you would have seen, high overhead, two great white birds. They flew swiftly, their legs stretched out and straight behind, their long white necks stretched out, their powerful wings beating steadily and strong. Ho-ho, ho-ho, ho-ho! A thrilling noise in the sky. The trumpeting of swans. When the birds spotted the pond, they began circling, looking the place over from the air. Then they glided down and came to rest in the water, folding their long wings neatly along their sides and turning their heads this way and that to study their new surroundings. They were trumpeter swans. Pure white birds with black bills. They had liked the looks of the swampy pond and decided to make it their home for a while and raise a family. The two swans were getting tired from the long flight. They were glad to be down out of the sky. They paddled slowly about and then began feeding, thrusting their necks into the shallow water and pulling roots and plants from the bottom. Everything about the swans was white, except their bills and their feet. These were black. They carried their heads high. The pond seemed a different place because of their arrival. For the next few days, the swans rested. When they were hungry, they ate. When they were thirsty, which was a great deal of the time, they drank. On the 10th day, the female began looking around to find a place to build her nest. In the spring of the year, nest building is the uppermost thing in a bird's mind. It is the most important task there is. If the swan picks a good place, she stands a good chance of hatching her eggs and rearing her young. If she picks a poor place, she may fail to raise a family. The female swan knew this. She knew the decision she was making was extremely important. The two swans first investigated the upper end of the pond where a stream flowed slowly in. It was pleasant there, with reeds and bulrushes. Red-winged blackbirds were busy nesting in that part of the pond, and a pair of mallard ducks were courting. Then the swans swam to the lower end of the pond, a marsh with woods on one side and a deer meadow on the other. It was lonely there. From one shore to a point of a land extended out into the pond. It was a sandy strip, like a little peninsula. And at the tip of it, a few feet out into the water, was a tiny island, hardly bigger than a dining room table. One small tree grew on the island, and there were rocks and ferns and grasses. Do you want to see a picture of it? Take a look at this, exclaimed the female, as she swam around and around. Oh-ho, replied her husband, who liked to have someone ask his advice. The swan stepped cautiously out onto the island. The spot seemed made to order, just right for a nesting place. While the male swan floated close by, watching, she snooped about until she found a pleasant spot on the ground. She sat down now to see how it felt to be there. She decided that it was the right size for her body. It was nicely located a couple feet from the water's edge. Very convenient. She turned to her husband. "What do you think?" she said. "An ideal location," he replied. "A perfect place. And I'll tell you why it's a perfect place," he continued majestically. "If an enemy, a fox, a coon, or a coyote, or a skunk wanted to reach this spot, with murder in his heart, he would have to enter the water and get wet. And before he could enter the water, he would have to walk the whole length of that point of land, and by the time we'd see him or we would hear him, and I would give him a hard time." The male swan stretched out his great wings 8 feet from tip to tip. And Casa Lake children, you might want to ask an adult in your family to help you measure out 8 feet at some point today so you can imagine what that might look like. And then he gave the water a mighty clout to show his strength. This made him feel better right away. When a trumpeter swan hits an enemy with its wing, it's like being hit with a baseball bat. A male swan, by the way, is called a cob. No one knows why, but that's what he's called. A good many animals have special names. For example, a male goose is called a gander. A male cow is called a bull. A male sheep is called a ram. A male chicken is called a rooster, and so on. Anyway, the thing to remember is that a male swan is called a cob. The cob's mate pretended not to notice that her husband was showing off. But she saw it all right, and she was proud of his courage. As mates go, he was a good one. The cob watched his beautiful mate sitting there on the tiny island. To his great joy, he saw her beginning to turn slowly round and around, keeping always in the same spot, treading the mud and grass. She was making the first motions of nesting. First, she squatted down in the place that she had chosen. Then she twisted around and around, tamping the earth with her broad webbed feet, hollowing it out to make it like a saucer. Then she reached out and pulled twigs and grasses toward her and dropped them at her sides and under her tail, shaping her nest to her body. The cob floated close to his mate. He studied every move she made. "Now another medium-sized stick, my love," he said. She poked her splendid, long, white, graceful neck as far as it would go, picked up a stick, and placed it at her side. "Now another bit of grass," said the cob. The female reached for grasses, for moss, for twigs, anything she could get her beak on. Slowly, carefully, she built up the nest until she was sitting on a big grassy mound. She worked at this task for a couple of hours and then knocked off for the day and slid into the pond again to take a drink and to have lunch. "A fine start," said the cob as he gazed back at the nest. "It's a perfect beginning. I don't know how you manage it so cleverly." "Come by it quite naturally," said his mate. "There's a lot of work to it, but on the whole, it's pleasant work." "Yes," said the cob. "And when you're done, you will have something to show for your trouble. You will have a swan's nest, a nest 6 feet across. What other bird could say that?" "Well," said his wife, "maybe a bald eagle can say that. You all know, because you've seen one." "Yes," said the cob, "but in that case, it wouldn't be a swan's nest. It would be an eagle's nest. It would be high up in an old tree somewhere, instead of right down next to the water, with all the conveniences that go with water." They both laughed at this. Then they began trumpeting and splashing and scooping up water and throwing it on their backs, darting about as though they had suddenly gone crazy with delight. "Ko-ho, ko-ho, ko-ho," they cried. Every wild creature within a mile and a half of the pond heard the trumpeting of the swans. The fox heard, the raccoon heard, the skunk heard. One pair of ears heard that did not belong to a wild creature. But the swans didn't know that. Who do you think it was? I'll leave you with that question. Tomorrow we'll read the next chapter. Chapter 3 is called A Visitor. Have a great day. We'll see you soon.